A bit of repackaging by the hippie generation now on BBC Four in part two of Folk Britannia.
In 1962 in Britain, folk music meant the Springfields on television and in the charts. Meanwhile, Ewan McCall, the architect of the British folk revival, was hitting his stride with the radio ballads.
It's there on the deep that we harvest and reap our bread.
But bubbling underneath, the children of Skiffle were mapping out the direction folk would take over the next 10 years. By the end of the 60s, folk music would be part of the widening British rock scene and would look and sound like this. And this. And even this.
Appalling weather conditions like these must add up to a railway boss's nightmare.
Well, nightmare is perhaps rather a strong word.
In the winter of 62, Bob Dylan visited London's folk clubs and treated them to his first original compositions and his repertoire of Woody Guthrie songs. But he discovered that the music and spirit of Guthrie had preceded him. Guitar-playing British beatniks were also trying to unravel the musical secrets of the American folk revival.
I had this little EP of Big Will Brinsey and I was amazed by the sounds I was hearing. And I could not understand how the sounds he was creating and the instrument, they didn't seem to relate to each other. I was mystified by it, you know. And that's how I first took guitar lessons.
Come on, let's hear it. Bum, bum, bum.
I loved Woody Guthrie. The way he sang, his voice was so great, his accent. I mean, that was the first thing I did. I learned his guitar style, I learned his accent as best I could. And I used to go around saying that I was from Oklahoma.
After I was on the highway to California, I made about three trips back to Texas and back to Oklahoma and back to California again by freight train. There was about 150 of us.
Tom Joad got loose from McAllister Pen. It's there that he got parole. After 4 long years on a man-killing charge, Tom Joad came walking down the farm.
It was Jack Kerouac on the road, all the beat poets, Ginsberg, all the people. I consider myself part of the tradition. I've always liked that, the idea of the lonesome hobo with his guitar strapped to his back, going down the railroad track alone, you know what I mean? That's always been my thing. I still like it.
You wanted to go out on the road, and it was as soon as possible. As soon as you could get some money together, you went. I was in Calais on the 21st of April, 1957. You know, so I sort of made a quick start. That's the date, the first date in stamp in my passport, right?
The 12 of Grandfather Jones made a mighty heavy load. But Grandfather Jones...
There was an axis between London and Paris, and a lot of the people who went to Paris had this idea that they would then travel south to Cannes, Nice and Menton.
You weren't the hobo that was catching the goods train. You were suddenly able to enact Kerouac's dream in Europe on the roads.
And it looked like the promised land, that bright green valley with a river running through. There was work for every single hand, they thought. There was work for every single hand.
In 1959, this generation of young European hard travellers found their own homegrown guru.
The first time I ever saw Davy was on that programme. I sat there watching this man play and I just couldn't believe what I was hearing and seeing. It was the first time I'd heard anybody of, you know, what you can loosely describe as our lot playing like that. He is the man who is responsible for the great leap forward, if you like, in guitar playing.
Dave was the leader. He was the first one. He's the beginning of the style. He would flit from here to there to everywhere. He'd stop halfway on along something and say, "Have you heard this?" and start something completely different. You know, so that you could never quite follow him.
In the days when everybody else was really scruffy with long beards and long hair and wearing scabby t-shirts and jeans, Davy was there and he was immaculate. 1950s jazzer.
Could actually take any sound he heard, anything, it didn't matter what it was, be it a Charlie Mingus big band, and condense it to one track or on a guitar. And no one else I've ever known has that ability, you know, to do that.
Davy Graham, a Londoner of mixed Scottish and Guyanese descent, was an elusive and mercurial hero. In 1962, he delivered his followers their first instrumental standard.
Davy doesn't like me doing it because I play it too fast and I play all the wrong notes. But I do still like actually playing it. It's called Angie.
When Bert Jansch released his solo LP in 1965, the American-inspired folk guitarist had produced a reluctant poster boy. But there were others still determined to build on the work of the English folk revival.
Come all ye jolly sporting men who love to go aloft, and I'll tell you of a mowing match come off at Brimmycross.
They sing in folk clubs all over the country. They travel around in an old van. They positively shun the limelight. These are the Watersons, a very important part of the revival of traditional British music.
There was a great gulf between what we did and what the blues guitarists did. We were excited by our own tradition. We were absolutely enthralled to the music. The music is dark, the music is fascinating, it's our, you know, it's our traditions.
In the old fortune telling, the knock come the door and the hawking.
You can lose yourself within yourself and forget completely about the audience.
And they can lose themselves in with you as well.
Well, that's the point,
to bring the audience into you instead of...
A significant fellow traveller of the Watersons was Anne Briggs.
We're all sort of singers. We're conditioned to singing in clubs. We're conditioned to be club performers now, which never was the role of folk singers before. Well, the thing is, what we've done, we've picked up the threads of a tradition. And we've not got, really, other than a few old recordings, we've not got anything else to go on.
I never found a single thread through, apart from a gut feeling. And that was the only thread that ran through it all, was that direct line that some singers had through singing their songs to the human emotion.
One morning fair to take the air down by Blackwater side.
I first heard Annie Briggs down at the Troubadour, and I suppose it would be 62. She was very young, 15 or something, 16. I walked in the door and I saw this woman singing, standing up with her hands behind her back. Her back just sang. And this lovely, fluid voice. Very straightforward singing, really wonderfully musical, and gorgeous timing.
All through the forepart of the night, while we lay in sport and play.
Anne Briggs sort of came out of nowhere. She had passion, and she took no prisoners. For her, folk song was visceral. It came from here, not from here. And if she sang a song that you already knew, like Lowlands Away, sea shanty, but she sang it as a love song, which of course it is in origin, before it became a sea shanty.
I thought, well, I can sing that song, but I feel differently about it. So I just thought I'd sing it the way that I felt about it. I love the sound of it, and I love the words of it, and I love the tune. And I just sang it, and it obviously didn't come out very shanty-like by the time I'd done with it.
I dreamed I saw my own true love, lowlands, lowlands away, my John.
Lowlands, lowlands away, my John.
But Martin Carthy was a sponge. He absorbed everything. He played a bell-like, tiny Martin guitar. An extraordinary style that he'd created. Assertive, but very gentle. Somehow he was reinterpreting, I think, fiddle music on his... He was doing things that nobody else was doing. And so he was a great student. I was a great student of Martin.
Lowlands away, my John. I dreamed a dream the other night.
By 1965, a whole circuit of folk clubs had grown up around this new generation of folkies. But most of these clubs were styled on Ewan McCall's more austere 50s model and functioned as a meeting place for the enthusiastic amateur.
The members of the Hampstead Folk Club enjoy a rather different sort of music. The club, which meets every Sunday night in a room over a pub, has been going for 9 months. And it's typical of at least 200 other similar clubs which have been mushrooming up all over the country.
When I arrived in Britain in April of 1964, I had very little idea about British folk music. I mean, to me it was sea shanties, Ewan McCall with his finger in his ear, boring. The typical club of that era was almost always in the assembly room of a pub. You go upstairs and there would be no stage, just a part of the room to stand in. And there'd be floor singers, and then just people in the audience getting up and singing a song.
Terry, give us a song.
At the Hampstead Club, singers are encouraged to get up from the floor and, as it were, cut their teeth. But for its high attendance figures, the club relies on professionals like Isla Cameron.
Don't sing sad songs, you'll wake my mother. She's sleeping here, close by my side.
Before, there were just a few of us, you know, Ewan McCall and Seamus Ennis and A.L. Lloyd and myself, and we did these rather esoteric programs on the third program. We used traditional music, but it wasn't as alive as it is now. And the nice thing about now is that everybody sings.
We were up long before the day.
I went around, went to folk clubs, and I started hearing all these amazing people, a lot of them singing a cappella. Went to folk clubs in Newcastle, went to Hull, I went to the Watersons Club. I had the passion of the newly converted.
This is the last song before we invite Louis back again, and it's the Helston
Mayday song. My rambling boy, may all you ramble and bring you joy.
I would find myself in a town on a Tuesday night, and it was like Saturday night, night after night, because every place I played was absolutely crammed. Tremendously exciting.
And a friend always stuck with me in the hard old days. Never again.
Now, that was a song about Hairy Mary, one of the best-known birds in Glasgow, a mother. And this next song is the story of how she became a mother.
Well, out to the east, there came a hard man. Oh, all the way from Brighton. Glory, hallelujah.
When I first went to folk clubs, 70% of the music you would hear would be American derivation. Tom Paxton played Pete Seeger before. And the Scots had never seen that sort of stuff before. And the way we get over it was to get kind of involved in the Communist Party, because they're all lefties, you know, Paxton's lefty, all the bias, all lefties.
VP Insider.
Scotland, it was like this huge musical stew. Glasgow was largely sort of blues-based, and everybody was sitting around trying to play blues guitar, possibly due to Hamish Inlack's influence.
Well then, Mary, you're one in a million. Oh, so's your chances.
There was a strong distinction between the way things developed in Edinburgh and the way they developed in Glasgow.
Bonnie lass, come out the barn, I'm the lass.
The way things developed in Edinburgh, it tended to be much more focused on traditional Scottish and Irish songs.
Well, it was the only place where old singers could play. Jimmy McBeath and Willie Scott and other Scottish performers that were traditional singers that had that were the bearers of that tradition, which is almost extinct apart from people like that. They used to play there to an enthusiastic and younger audience, you know, young audience, because folk music at that point was trendy.
Born in England's pleasant green, like a picture postcard scene, to childhood spread with fond maternal care.
And nowhere was more fashionable than the London folk club scene, where an army of earnest young middle-class boys dreamed of being Davy Graham or maybe even Bob Dylan.
In boyhood sent away to a boarding school to stay.
I would hitch up from Bristol, then the cousins in Greek Street in Soho ran all-nighters and hard benches and people in duffel coats, and if the music was good, they were really with you, and if the music wasn't, they were very happy to sleep because it was the cheapest hotel in London.
Into manhood's search for truth, his mother's eyes now wet and turned to stare.
Everybody would end up down there. I mean, all the people on the what was called the contemporary folk scene in the day, the guitar players, the songwriters, some of the traditionalists, the blues guys. You never knew who was going to turn up.
To sing, to sing. Is a state of mind.
If any American singers were in town, they would come down. If it was Albert Grossman who was bringing the singers in, then you would get Odetta, you would get Bob Dylan.
Are you going to
the Scarborough Fair. Parsley, sage, rosemary and thyme.
It was like Martin was the centre. It was extraordinary. When Dylan first came to England, the first person he wanted to meet was Martin Carthy. When Paul Simon first came, he went direct to Martin Carthy. It was almost, and got Scarborough Fair.
She once was a true love of mine.
It was a perfect time to be here. It was so exciting. And I began to play in little folk clubs. A lot of the early Simon and Garfunkel songs and hits, and they're really about my travels in England.
Paul came over here in the same way that Dylan came over here, to discover British folk music and take from it what he could. Paul is the only guy, I've ever known so far who could stretch out full length in the front of a Land Rover with a trench coat on, right?
I can recall one evening when I went to the Cousins and Paul Simon was top of the bill. And Paul Simon finally came on, and before he started the number, said, "I've just been told on the phone that I'm number one in America," and proceeded to play the song.
As Paul Simon himself said, at that time when he was in London, we were all learning off everybody else. If somebody came up with a new trick, everybody was latching onto it, because we all of us wanted to improve. You know, we all latched onto everything that Davey did.
Davey Graham has a theory that there is a connection between Oriental music and the folk music of Ireland. And to prove this, he's going to play for us his own variation of the Irish melody, She Moves Through the Fair.
Davey's version of She Moves Through the Fair, I was absolutely stunned by this. It was improvisational, but he was also using the guitar in a way I'd never heard it used before. It just blew me away. I couldn't figure out how he'd done it. The guy who played it to me, a guy called Gordon Geeky, Gordon explained to me that he had the guitar tuned differently. And that was something that had never occurred to me.
What Davey was getting away from was the idea that you had to be orchestral. He was playing melodically rather than harmonically, and the chords are suggested rather than imposed.
To tune the guitar something like the sitar, the sarod, and I took up the oud, the Arab lute. I played the sarod for about 10 years, not to anybody's, nobody noticed, I don't think, but I was quite serious about the Arab lute. I never mastered the question and answer antiphonal responses between treble and bass that you get with that sort of music. It's more particularly the natural style on the instrument.
He's a very hard man to follow. I don't mean musically, but I mean I'd like to keep up with him. Because he'll jump from one subject to another mid-sentence, you know. It's all logical in his mind.
I spent nearly 20 years studying Afghan and Iraqi Takassim modes, and they strike the lover of English folk music very oddly, if at all, if at all.
Joseph husband, come tell me why.
But Davy Graham was never one to shirk a challenge, and for his next musical adventure, he teamed up with folk's most celebrated English rose.
Shirley Collins was part of what you might call the first wave of the post-war revival. A very sweet voice, singing songs largely from the Sussex repertoire, from the Coppers and people like that.
As soon as I saw Blonde, I must confess to you, she nearly knocked me sideways.
He was lovely, but he was cold. And although the music itself was so utterly passionate, you know, he was a sort of dispassionate person. Very disciplined, except he took drugs, you know, which I didn't.
But to hear Shirley sing, "I rode to church last Sunday, my true love passed me by, I knew his love was changing from the rolling of his eye," you know. Just looked so absolutely wonderful, you know. And just so struck by her as a all I loved about England, about green sleeves, about Vaughan Williams' Fantasia on a theme by Thomas Tallis, all that.
It was wonderful to work with him because he really did sort of enhance this music and give it such sort of strength, I think, as well, and present it to people in a way that we hadn't thought to hear, you know, we hadn't thought of listening to it like that before.
In Ottoman town, not a soul would look up.
By fusing the two strands of the folk movement, Folk Roots, New Roots became a defining moment for British folk music.
I think it was influential in the sense of opening people's ears to the wider possibilities of what was being done. I think without that album, we wouldn't have had Pentangle, we wouldn't have had Fairport's Legion Leaf.
Proud Misery stands in the
While Davy Graham and Shirley Collins' fusions were well received critically, they barely registered commercially. But over in America, a mighty wind was blowing.
I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up and live out the true meaning of its creed.
By the mid-60s, folk music and the civil rights movement were almost synonymous. Bob Dylan had become the living embodiment of the protest singer.
A young singer from New York, Bob Dylan.
Oh, the time will come up when the winds will stop and the breeze will cease to be breathing.
But at the same time, his songs were being sweetened up and straightened out for a mass audience.
Oh, the seas will split and the ship will hit, and the sand on the shoreline will be shaking.
I found my love by a gasworks croft.
The Spinners were trying the same trick with Ewan McCall's songs in England without the same commercial success. But then in 1965, British Folk produced its first pop star.
Yellow is the colour of my true love's hair in the morning when we rise in the morning. When we rise, that's the time, that's the time I love the best.
There was
a folk invasion of the American charts by Joan Baez and Peter, Paul and Mary. So I saw that, and I thought, I want to be part of that. I knew that I was going to do it. I intended. And I was reading Buddhism and Celtic philosophy, and now I wanted to be the voice, like Joan was, like Peter, Paul and Mary. I knew that I could bring in meaningful lyrics into popular culture.
He made his very first appearance on Ready, Steady, Go, and I'm terribly proud of him because I think he's come up so quickly. You know, he's only been going for about 3 months. I think it's marvellous. I hate people who say he's a copy of Dylan because I think he's very talented in his own right.
I think you've given the game away. Tell us who it is.
It's Sensational Donovan.
This is called Catch the Wind. In the chilly hours and minutes of uncertainty, I want to be in the warm hall of your love and mine.
Gypsy Dave said, I found a new record by a new American artist, and he's doing exactly what you're doing. I said, what am I doing? He said, you're doing Woody Guthrie with a cap and a harmonica. I said, well, who is this guy? He says, well, he's called Bob Dylan. So I said, send me his record. So he sent down Freewheeling Bob Dylan. And when I put it on, I said, yeah, he's doing it as well. Some people did say, oh, they've dressed him up, they put a cap on him. They couldn't believe that I really was a vagabond, that I'd really left society, turned my back on it, challenging hypocrisy and greed, becoming a bohemian to sing about society's ills.
But while Donovan was catching the wind of protest, Dylan was already dragging folk music, kicking and screaming, into a whole new 60s world.
Was the loudest thing I think most people had ever heard. And Lomax and Seeger, they went nuts. And they demanded that I get the sound turned down. Dylan, when he first arrived on the scene and he wrote all those fantastic, powerful political songs, the old guard, the left, the folk left, just thought all their Christmases had come at once. I mean, this was what they'd been praying for ever since Woody Guthrie got ill. But by the summer of 1965, they were getting very nervous because Dylan seemed to be wandering off somewhere. This was a moment where you knew at the time that things would not be the same.
Having seen the future, Joe Boyd, the production manager of the 1965 Newport Folk Festival, joined a growing number of Americans in Britain to scout for talent. But it wasn't Swinging London that first caught his attention.
Scotland in general, and Edinburgh in particular, were epicenters of a kind of drug culture in the 60s, in which a lot of people smoked dope, a lot of people took acid, in a way that didn't exist in England, in the folk scene. I mean, people smoked dope, maybe, but there weren't too many mind-blown folk singers.
LSD then, most of it, I think, originated from psychiatric hospitals, the early stuff. It was in a sort of sugar cube form. And I remember when it had just really become available in Scotland. And we all tried it. Plus, we tried everything, really. Romila, everything. We tried them all.
I had a tree in the dream hills where my childhood lay, and I'd go there in the wide long days, and my tree would listen to all that I'd say, and the sun was shining.
In the back room of a tiny pub in the back of Edinburgh somewhere, I heard the Incredible String Band Robin and Clive were kind of distorting Scottish music completely unlike anything I'd ever heard before. It was not like anything that was happening in America. And so it had this real freshness of something genuinely British and echoes of, you know, Scots traditional music, but echoes of Eastern Europe and echoes of William Blake and echoes of God knows what in this thing. And they kept playing me more and more songs. They were all great.
Ravi Shankar would come every year. We'd be, have access to that, you know, and modern jazz records and Bulgarian records as well. And out of that whole mixture, we cobbled together a kind of music that we would like to hear.
It was totally free. Somebody singing and going... Duh, duh, duh. You're thinking, wait a minute, there's no form here. And then you realise that that's what it is.
The ideas that I feel that I added to that mixture was the notion of trying to play instruments that you couldn't actually play at all, getting away from technique, like naive painting except with music. There's so many things in junk shops, you know, big gongs and things that come back from the British Raj, yeah, and bells and Tibetan chimes, and we just thought, I'll have a go with this, make a noise on that, clang on this, thump on that, squeak on the other.
An elephant madness has covered the sun, and the judge and the jury still play for the fun. They've torn all the roses, washed all the soap, and the martyr who marries them dares not elope.
I sort of took the Incredible String Band and said, no, we're not going into the folk scene at all, we're going over here. Same audience that's coming to hear Pink Floyd will come to hear Robin and Mike. It couldn't have been a more different world than the world of Upstairs at the Black Horse in terms of the audience. You know, but there were probably crossovers in the audience. Kids who started out listening to folk music, you know, getting their minds blown and going down to UFO and becoming Pink Floyd fans or Soft Machine fans.
Audiences were fairly open-minded, so that they'd let you play almost anything. You know, they listen to the Incredible String Band, and they tolerate, you know, 20 minutes between songs while the Increds are trying to figure out which instrument they're going to play on which song.
I do think that a lot of what was done in those days was done on drugs.
The composer of life has arrived with his wife, as composed as a cup of tea.
Aldous Huxley. I read The Doors of Perception and I thought, this is the biggest lot of sense I've ever read in my life. There's nothing mystic about this. You know, page after page of right down to earth factual. There it was.
In 1968, while the folk movement was busy hugging trees, out in the real world, Rome was burning. Folk had travelled light years away from its 50s socialist roots, much to the frustration of Ewan McCall and Peggy Seeger. In a last-ditch attempt to wrest back control of folk music, they set up the Critics Group.
It was a group of young people who Ewan gathered to himself centered on his flat in Beckenham. And they were the people who were going to work together. They were going to learn how to be traditional singers, how to present the songs in the way that Ewan and Peggy felt was the way the song should be handed over.
We didn't start the critics group. Singers came to us and said, we are city singers. We haven't been brought up with this music. We don't know how to do it. We have been listening to classical music, music hall, rock music, da-da-da-da-da. How do we do a 9-minute unaccompanied ballad?
I remember looking around the room. There were very few women there. Charles Parker, the radio producer, was there. You and Charles both had these little sort of chin-strap beards, very neatly carved, and a little bit, I think a little bit of a bit of hair going up here. And I looked around the room, and all the other blokes there, they all had these little beards. So there was Ewan and Charles and everybody else with these beards. That was, for me, it was a sort of warning sign. I thought,
By 1968, Ewan McCall's brand of folk music seemed hopelessly old-fashioned. His control of the scene was ebbing away, a fact underlined by the emergence of Pentangle, the folk purist's worst nightmare. A couple of Davy Graham disciples on guitar, a folky girl singer, all driven by a jazz rhythm section.
And in the place your time was waste, spread all our withering rue. We'll spread all our withering.
It was unheard of, really, I suppose. Was I jazzing up the folkies? Those folk idols, you know. And there was this... So I don't know what they made of it. A lot of people didn't like it, especially when we started using amplifiers. I used to get death threats.
Let's get away, you say, find a better place. Miles and miles away from the city's waste. Look around for someone...
We used to have solos in the band, and... That would involve, 20-minute solo from Danny.
I used to get more space within an ensemble like that than doing Ronnie's. The fact that Terry, the drummer, was a very sympathetic and rhythmic percussionist, and he wasn't all over the drum kit like drummers tend to do, gave you that space. And I did take liberties.
We got into the jazz habit of actually leaving the stage to let them perform. We could actually leave anybody on the stage. We would actually get to the point where if, when we wanted to have a drink, we would devise it so that Jackie would be left on the stage on her own. And we'd all manage to get to the bar and have a drink. And sometimes we forget that she was actually still up there. You know? But it did mean we were doing, like, 2-hour, 3-hour shows.
But it wasn't just McCall who was reacting to the meanderings of jazz and acid folk. Over in America, Bob Dylan's old backing band was playing roots music with a full-on electric backbeat. And it was soon picked up on in Britain.
I had the Incredible String Band, but I wanted a group that played electric instruments and had a drummer. And I heard this group, Fairport Convention. And everything, all my prejudices were sort of up on end, saying, oh, no, please. This is basically American folk rock. And then Richard took a solo. And I just went, what? This kid is 17 years old. He just took a solo like that. Jesus, this kid is amazing. And So I did the cliche, you know, I walked into the dressing room and said, here's a contract you want to sign, you know.
Adieu, adieu, hard was my fate. I was brought up in a tender state. But company, it didn't me entice. I left off work and took bad advice, which makes me now to lament and say, pity the fate of young felons all. Oh, well, oh, day, well, oh, day. I robbed Lord Gold when I do declare.
In an effort to switch to a more English sound, Fairport Convention recruited two well-known faces from the folk scene, fiddler Dave Swarbrick and a young singer-songwriter called Sandy Denny.
I was worried that Sandy was too powerful of personality. The Fairport guys were all quite sort of shy and quiet. Sandy was effing and blinding and knocking over drinks and, you know, spilling cigarette ash everywhere and, you know, shouting. And I just thought she'd eat them for breakfast. But once she played with them, she was so in awe of Richard's musicianship that she went, okay, just tell me what to do at first.
We were really trying to build around her. We just listened to her sing and just get kind of find places, you know, percussion, drum, bass, and guitars. We were just kind of fitting around, and I think that was a good approach. It worked very well.
She not only livened them up a bit as from her personality, and made them musically, vocally, much more powerful as a band. But she got Richard writing songs. You know, she wrote songs, why couldn't Richard?
With a whole new English repertoire, Fairport Convention's new lineup recorded Legion Leaf in 1969. Folk rock was born.
They took the floor spot, gave it an amplifier, and it swung like the clappers. And singing traditional songs.
It had such power. At the time I was going deaf, couldn't hear very well. All of a sudden I could hear, Jesus, you could hear me in Timbuktu, you know.
I remember very clearly the sense of excitement. What are we going to do today? Are we going to work on Richard trading licks on the electric guitar with Swarb on the fiddle? Or were we going to work on ballads with Sandy singing and we'd have to kind of work out what we were going to play behind, you know? Very exciting time.
Somehow Sandy still out of... probably more than any of the rest of the folk rock people, Sandy still managed to retain that sense of song and story and had a hold of the essence of things. And I might...
We're going to reinvent English folk music. She was excited at first. She thought, wow, this is fantastic. But she then realized it didn't really include songs like Who Knows Where the Time Goes. What did that got to do with English folk music? I mean, she was loved singing Richard's songs, but she wanted them to be singing her songs too. So I think that was the key reason why she left.
Miss the morning too, didn't rise before noon. She's a lazy lady.
Sandy was so high maintenance, and we thought, well, you know, it'll be an easier life with Sandy out of the band. So let's look on the one positive to come out of this, you know.
You're a crazy lady.
She was like a man in some ways in those days, where she, you know, she said what she thought and she went out with who she wanted to, and you know, had one night stands if she wanted to, and did all those things that were a little unusual in those days.
Now should I say more? For I know you so well.
But she was wild and wonderful.
What we were seeing was the emergence of people like me and Sandy, who are saying, right, yeah, okay, we're women. Times are changing, you know. We can go out and drink in pubs, and you know, we can travel around, and we can do anything, you know. And we did.
It wasn't a real women's lib time. It was pre-women's lib. I think that was the sort of image that women had that were involved in the folk scene. I don't know anybody that was sort of girly. We're all, it reminds me of that song Jackaro, you know, men's clothing she put on, da, 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 da. And it feels like we needed to, in order to experience the kind of situations that you sang about in these songs, you had to have the strength of a man.
Mania never lay a head down without a hand to hold. Mania never make your bed out in the cold.
While the girls were being boys, the boys were exploring their feminine side. Many of Davy Graham's guitar disciples, like Al Stewart, Ralph McTell and John Martin, began to dominate the folk club scene with their personal songs of love and introspection.
The protest song was a big thing, and normally it was anti-war or anti-this or anti-that. I always went for balance myself. I'd rather protest about my heart than the state of politics.
Another sensitive singer-songwriter was Nick Drake.
Which way you go for? Which way you love?
At the time that they were released, people didn't know which bin to put them in. Nick, it doesn't surprise me that he's not considered part of the folk world, because his harmonies, his voicings, his attitude, he's certainly not influenced by English folk music. He's much more influenced by the romantic poets.
For your one and all, a diamond now.
If you want English music properly played, then Nick Drake was the most modern and the most accomplished of any of those. I mean, I don't know. More sensitive than Davy. More sensitive than just about anyone I can think of.
Which way?
In 1970, Nick Drake was just another obscure singer-songwriter. All the attention had by now shifted to folk rock. Which way? However, few could have anticipated acoustic stalwart Martin Carthy strapping on an electric guitar to join folk rock band Steel I Span.
Shall I bring that microphone in?
Yes, please do.
Here we are, Maddie. Is that all right?
Yes, lovely.
I went out and bought my bright blue Telecaster. Taught me economy. Taught me to play less, and the amount of noise you make has got very little to do with it.
They were a bit like a British version of the Velvet Underground. They had a couple of electric guitars and that droning viola, and it had that real kind of icy medieval nighttime sound.
On the log in the morning
Martin Carthy wouldn't have conventionally been described as a rock singer, but nor was Maddie Pryor. Good rock singers have voices that cut through shitty PA systems.
Had all the army, he was a gallant sire.
Maddie Pryor had that high arc of a voice which you could probably have sort of fired from here to Nova Scotia.
Steel I Span was the realisation of the 60s generation's artistic quest to present British folk music to a contemporary audience. But their success led to a commercial explosion of folk rock in the early 70s.
People suddenly began to realise that there was money to be made out of folk music. Tim Hart and Maddie Pryor, who were a duo in the folk clubs, suddenly became Steel I Span. That seemed to happen overnight. They had a bass player and drummer. Fairports were going out and doing big audiences.
Cause the fog on the town is all mine, all mine. The fog on the town is all mine.
Lindisfarne came along and had a huge hit.
All mine. Fog on the town is all mine.
We were the biggest at the time. We entered the charts and were in there for 54 weeks.
Could a copper catch a crooked coffin maker? Could a copper comprehend?
Fog on the Tyne certainly was the biggest selling album of 1972. There was only comparable sales from John Lennon's Imagine and Bridge Over Troubled Water by Simon and Garfunkel.
It was all happening as part of the folk rock scene. These records began to make the charts. All Around My Hat put pop into folk music. Suddenly, we had a hit with Part of the Union.
Part of the Union from the Straubs.
Now I'm a union man, amazed at what I am. I say what I think, that the company stinks. Yes, I'm a union man.
At a time when Ted Heath's Conservative government was going head-to-head with the unions, folk rock delivered a chart-topping hit with a distinctly anti-union message, turning the traditional role of folk music on its head.
You don't get me, I'm part of the union. You don't get me, I'm part of the union. You don't get me.
As the left-wing roots were forgotten, by the mid-70s, folk rock had become a parody of its former self. It had also stolen the audience from the once vibrant folk club scene, as Martin Carthy discovered when he left the folk rock world to go back to his roots.
It had become apparent that the folk clubs, they could be very, very easily satisfied. You didn't have to be that good. There was too much of this, oh, it's just folk music. It's just ordinary people. That means it's ordinary music. And it's and what that meant for them was that it's actually not very good, but it doesn't matter.
The folk clubs were not alone in their problems. Many of the folk scene's originators were also struggling. Heroin addiction had left Davy Graham a rare and erratic performer, while Anne Briggs had stopped singing altogether.
I did allow myself to be used so much and so intensely as a vehicle for the material. I think I was possibly quite drained by that process.
Very few people noticed Nick Drake's premature death, and Sandy Denny was also in pretty bad shape.
She had the baby and she was drinking and doing drugs and stuff like that. Sometimes she'd leave the baby behind in the pub or in the car or something. You know, she was just a bit out of it, I think.
On April 17th, 1978, Sandy Denny was found in a coma after a fall. She died a few days later. The 60s generation seemed to have hit a brick wall. But much needed new life would be breathed into folk music by the next generation.
Once a sass mile, once a euro one, go to the waxy stag, to Sierra, once a mile one, I forgot a Berlin. I went out to Montauk, Tennessee, on Gilmagago.